Is Sword Art Online good? Such a simple question, and yet I am making a super long video about the topic for the third time. SAO. Never before has a show so average caused me to say so much. Because that's the thing. There's so much to say about it. There is so much someone could dig into if they want to about all the things it does right or wrong. There are tons of interesting things going on in the world. Ideas about video games, artificial intelligence, and just technology as a whole. But then there are parts that make no sense. When the writers seem to have no idea what they're doing, other than trying to make Kirito look cool. But then something cool happens, and I forget about all my complaints. SAO is not a simple show to talk. This video will be spoiling all of Season 3, or Season 3 Part 1, or whatever it's called. The two cores that aired before this video came out. Alright, let's get into this. The season starts by showing Kirito in a fantasy world. There are a lot of questions about what's going on, but one of the things I like is that the show is not quick to give us answers. It just shows Kirito living here as a kid, with these two other characters, Yu-Gi-Oh and Alice, and we see things about the world slowly unraveled, like how it's been around for hundreds of years. There's magic, sort of, and a list of rules called the Taboo Index. I really enjoyed how this world was portrayed. It was something new, fantastical, and the lack of answers didn't bog down the story any. If anything, it helped the immersion. Then the second part of the first episode got into Kirito back in the real world and gave us a few pieces of information about what was going on. And there we learned that the fantasy world is a new video game world made for research purposes. Then Kirito is stabbed and taken back to the fantasy world to keep him alive. This is a cliche way of doing it, but I don't mind. In fact, this frames the whole season as SAO trying to do the isekai genre right, learning from the mistakes of the earlier seasons while utilizing all the strengths that it had before. And for a while, it seemed to be working out really well. The world is really vast and interesting, plus there are a lot of interesting ideas about AI and the impact on society as a whole. Though it doesn't take long to start to see similar problems with the earlier seasons here again, such as Kirito being overpowered here as well with his sword skill. And that really doesn't make sense if you start to think about it. Yes, the reason Kirito is OP is because he had the skills in the earlier games, but why would that transfer over? You could make the argument that the games use a similar framework, but why would that include the character accounts? And even if they could transfer the accounts, why would they do so? If the whole point of the experiment was for Kirito to be a normal person, except to be a real person, so wouldn't him be super strong mess with that? Though I get it, I'm probably just overthinking the whole thing, and I will accept that. It is a pretty minor nitpick at this point in the show, so I will let this one slide. Anyway, the two good parts of the first 7 or so episodes are the world with Kirito exploring and trying to figure out what is going on, and then the greater themes about AI. Plus, there are a lot of smaller plots too throughout these episodes, along with a share of cool action, such as the battle against the goblins, and I like that Kirito really did struggle here. And then there's a lot I liked when we switched back to Asuna for that episode or so, and we saw what was going on with Kirito's body. I really enjoyed feeling the bond that Kirito and Asuna shared, and how I could feel just how much they care about each other. And I also liked how Klein was helpful in driving her around, though I wish that the old characters did have more of an impact in this new season. When Asuna finally made it to where Kirito is, they learned a lot about what was going on with Kirito and the world that he is in, along with the military purpose behind it all. And I found this part really fascinating for a lot of reasons. The scientists want to create true AIs so that they can be used to fight wars, because if it's just an AI that dies, it means nothing. Which definitely makes a lot of sense. That's why drones are used so much. There's no human cost if they're shot down. The colonel even makes the comment that 100,000 AI are worth less than a human, which again, it makes complete sense. Unless the AI are actually real. And this is where the science fiction of the show sort of breaks down, and where my knowledge of computing makes me start to question the show. I actually studied AI a bit in school, and have even written some AI programs for my job before, and while they are powerful computing tools, there's nothing human in them. It's like if I'm playing a game against an AI, it may be able to replicate how a person plays, but there's no illusion that there is a real person there I'm fighting. There's just something fundamentally human that the AI is lacking, even when it models a human. But SAO addresses this in a way that I find works surprisingly well, and that is by utilizing several non-understood things together. In the show, they use a light cube to copy a flux light. The light cube is a light quantum gate crystal, and the flux light is the quantum field that is the human soul. So they're basically copying a human soul into the computer. And let me tell you how this sort of makes sense. The human soul is not understood, if it even exists. But I subscribe to the theory that it does because I am me. Like, I am myself. I am not someone else. There's something that makes me, me, not just the physical body. Or at least that's how it feels, like there's something beyond the physical. So, this could be a quantum field, something beyond what is seen. And while this might be a stretch, I'd accept it as being possible. And the light cube is a sort of quantum memory, which is able to store a quantum state, and while they do not state it explicitly, the underworld could be run in a quantum computer that would allow the light cubes to be storing the copied souls. So yes, some hand-waving here, certainly. But as someone who is normally very picky with sci-fi explanations, this one does feel quite plausible. There's also all the other ideas brought up in the episode about a copy not being able to cope with the fact it is a copy, or how a newborn can be raised in a virtual world. I also find it really interesting how they talk about how this is science is really fascinating, but it is being used for military purposes, which is something that is very real. At least in America, a ton of science is funded by the military, and they are not just doing that out of the goodness of their hearts. Then, of course, there's the fact that the artificial people in the game world aren't quite human. They don't have the ability to rebel against the taboo index, at least until Kirito gives them that option. There's some religious symbolism here, I believe, but we'll get to that later. At this point in the show, after episode 6, everything is going wonderfully. The show has capitalized on its strengths of before, the cool action of season 1, and the interesting ideas of season 2. It's also slowed the pace down, letting the fantasy world become its own setting, while having interesting plot lines going on both in and out of the game world. There are a few nitpicks I can make, but they really don't matter here. Then episode 7 starts with a time skip. And it's at this point that the cracks in the show's foundation start to make themselves known. I even wrote in my notes that this episode just was pretty bad. The time skip itself is very jarring to the plot and the pacing they established. And time skips often feel like they're done when the writers just don't have anything plot relevant to the show, so they just skip forward. Then there's a dull information dump about what had happened, which just felt dull. Information dumps as a whole are one of the biggest issues with the show. They need the viewer to know things, so they spend a considerable amount of time just having the characters explain it to each other. Narratively, it kind of makes sense since Kirito and Yujiro need to know what is going on, but it's just very dull. Like, the animation for these is as basic as they can get. So there's nothing really interesting to watch, you're just listening, and while occasionally these can work if what is being said is really interesting, this is rarely the case. There are some interesting things that are going on past the time skip, though. Kirito is more of a rebellious person, contrasting the other characters who just instinctively obey the rules. A small touch I liked is how Kirito enjoyed just coming in through a window. And yes, it is funny when a character comes in or leaves via a window, but it also shows how Kirito is not someone who will just automatically follow the rules. But one of the big issues that starts to make itself known here is the characters. And no, I'm not just talking about Kirito being overpowered. But as a character, Kirito is not that interesting. He doesn't have a desire to get back home that I would have expected. He's just accepted that this is his life without any explanation. Yujiro also isn't that interesting, though there are parts with him wanting to get stronger which I do like. And the characters aren't exactly bad, but they don't have an appeal to make me want to see more of the characters. Yes, they're good people who I can kind of root for, but I want something more. Episodes 9 and 10, though. These were episodes to remember. In a good way, sort of. These episodes has Kirito and Yujiro being the senior students, each having a girl younger than them as an apprentice. Again, lots of interesting ideas explored here, showing the different classes in society, portraying those with power and those without, and how their rules tend to bend to favor those on top. There's a line in episode 9 that states, "You can do whatever you want as long as you don't break the taboo." That line stood out. It shows how people in power can use and abuse the law, doing actions that are perfectly legal, but violated the intended purpose of the law, not to mention any morality that the law may have been built upon. Then there's another line by one of the apprentices, how those with power must use it for those without. And this reveals that society has those with power and those without. But there's an inherent responsibility for those who have been given power to use it for good. Sure, this idea has been done many times before. See Spider-Man, but it is still a good one to see. This episode really hit all the emotions right, with Yujiro and Kirito comforting the apprentice after she learned what was happening to her friend. And I liked how cute the apprentice and Yujiro were together. Like, they could have made a really good couple, growing stronger together. Maybe even becoming a couple kind of like how Kirito and Asuna are. That would have been really great. Granted, the show did not go that direction, but we'll get to that a bit later. And then there's also the fact that the apprentice was completely forgotten like 2 episodes later, which, yeah, It's like SEO has these interesting ideas for characters, but then they just throw them away unless they're Kirito or Asuna. Anyway, this episode itself was really good. Another line I loved was how the apprentice was saying that she wanted to be strong enough to say and do what's right. And this is so true. But life isn't that simple. Sometimes we have to do what we know is wrong because we lack strength. Sure, it's easy to say that you should always stick with your convictions. But when you risk the ire of those who have strength and power, especially over you, it is much harder to do so. Then episode 10 had the incident that I'm not going to describe in detail because I did not want YouTube to bury this video any more than it already will. It got rather dark and serious, not just in the subject matter, but the tone, and I like this. The show is making the point that the actions of the villains here are seriously messed up. This is one of the most powerful episodes in the entire show. Maybe beaten out by the season finale of season 2. Maybe. But I love this episode. I can feel Yuji's desperation to help these girls, his determination, but also his powerlessness when he was ordered by the noble to just stand there and watch, and then how it took everything within him to will himself free of the ingrained desire to obey the index. But when he broke free and slashed that guy's arm off, oh, that was so cool to see. And Violet too, that I liked. But then Kirito came to save his husbando because, of course, Kirito did. And then the two of them were found to have violated the index for attacking the noble. After they are found to violate the index, Yuji comments how he is like a goblin for what he did. And I feel this is probably a coincidence, but remember, Goblin Slayer was the show that aired the same season as this. Keep in mind what the goblins in that show did. Yeah, so if Yuji thinks that him doing the right thing, fighting to save someone he cares about, acting in defense of her, in his mind though, he is basically no better than a monster. This mindset is so messed up. And it shows what happens when a morality is based upon arbitrary rules instead of doing what is really right and wrong. This episode created a lot of controversy with its subject matter, which really isn't surprising with how sensitive of a subject the matter is. But I appreciated this episode of SAO. It had a dark tone, letting it take the subject seriously. And the events that happened were realistic, at least to a degree. People in power do abuse those without in the real world, sometimes in this very way. Is it right that these things happen? Absolutely not. But it would be wrong for art not to portray such a subject matter when it is so real. And with the themes in place here, this could have been a catalyst to a great story about those who abuse this power, those who fight against them, and that would justify the use of such an extreme episode. Or SAO could just become a generic dull action show. I really wanted to like SAO. I wanted to like season 3. I did like it for a while. I wanted to keep liking it. But it is SAO. After episode 10, the show just became very bland. There are very few surprises. The thematic depth that the first part of the show set up felt underutilized. It's basically Kirito and Yuji breaking out of jail, going up to the cathedral, fighting people until they got to the administrator, and then they beat her. Yes, I'm leaving a lot out, which I'll get back to, but it just felt like there is no impact here. And that made the dark and serious story in episodes 9 and 10 feel like shock factor, as opposed to something that fit with the overall story of the anime. I don't believe that scenes like that should not be included in anime storytelling, but to include it uncharacteristically in a show where it doesn't fit makes it just feel like the show is trying to be more serious and mature than it actually is. Alright, I think I've said enough about those couple episodes, so let's move on. So far when making this video, I've been pulling from the notes I took as I was watching the show, because, well, there's a lot that stood out that I wanted to remember. But after this point, I went episodes without anything noteworthy happening, so I can't really go into a lot of detail with those episodes. There isn't much to talk about. It felt like the writers just had the goal that they needed to reach in the end, which is have Yuji and Kirito find Alice and then get to the top of the cathedral and then defeat Administrator, and then just guided the plot along to get to that point without much thought to smaller goals. A good story needs this overarching goal, but also needs smaller goals that are also interesting. There are a number of battles along the way, but these are against just one-off villains that aren't really interesting. It felt like these villains were just here so Kirito and Yuji would have someone to fight. And not to mention, there are a lot of things that happened in the battles that felt like they were just to give Kirito and Yuji the win. Now, I won't say the part was all that bad. I liked Kirito and Yuji's friendship, how Yuji was able to learn from Kirito. And I liked how Yuji's passion to save Alice is what pushes him forward, but also makes him hate his enemies, not seeing them as people. One of the things I like about Kirito is his empathy. He's able to see the enemies as more than just his opponent, even willing to sacrifice the weapon he got from Cardinal to save one of them. They meet an elevator operator who has been doing this job 100 years and has lost any sense of purpose or drive to do anything else. And the state of this character really gets to Kirito. Something cool I noticed when watching part of season 1 with a friend while I was watching season 3 was how back in season 1, Kirito cared about the NPCs despite them not being alive, so seeing him care about the characters here just makes sense and is a nice continuity touch. But again, other than these small touches, there wasn't much I liked. If it wasn't SAO, I probably would have just dropped it. I'm not going to call the show the worst thing ever, because it's not. But after all the great build-up in the start, it just felt like a big letdown. A traditional action show when there are 20 of them every year. Plus, the exposition parts were just boring, though I talked about that already. After episode 20 or so is when the show started to get more interesting, though not necessarily in a good way. This is the part of the show where they learn about the Senate and have the big final battle against the Prime Senator and Administrator. One of the things I appreciated about this part is that the show slowed down, giving several episodes for all the fights, which let it feel like a big climax to this season, or part of the season, or whatever it is. One of the things that stood out to me is how the Senators, who are monitoring the world, were just kept in these capsules. There's something inhuman about them, or how they have been robbed of their humanity. They're basically robots, just like the elevator operator. They're doing a job without a thought for themselves, and it's just a very haunting scene. I also have to give credit for the voice acting for the Prime Senator. It is so messed up and filled with insanity that makes a character really stand out. And they could have made this finale great, but it also kept holding itself back. For example, the administrator was naked the entire fight, which made it really hard to take her seriously as a villain. I guess there might be some thematic reason you could justify her being naked, but it just seemed to be there for no reason. Then there's also the comedy in episode 21 that just felt really out of place for a big, exciting climax. And the action itself in these final few episodes was characteristic of SAO. For the most part, pretty basic, but cool enough to be enjoyable. And I also liked how we really felt the power of the administrator, how much stronger she was than anyone else. There was also a major cost to the heroes winning here, with both Cardinal and even Yu-Gi-Oh! Dying in the process. I really did not expect Yu-Gi-Oh! To die, and I respect the show for doing that, though I'm not quite sure the logic behind Yu-Gi-Oh! Turning into a sword himself made sense, or if it did, how that gave him the strength to defeat a weapon made of dozens of people, and then also how Kirito got the power of the Black Swordsman to defeat the Administrator, and how that was enough. So yeah, lots of small logic issues, and that's why I'm conflicted about the ending. I could pick apart the logic, like the plot armor for Kirito and all that, but as I was watching it, I was enjoying how cool the action was, getting into the suspense and the emotions. Or another example, Yu-Gi-Oh's final death. You have Yu-Gi-Oh on the verge of a death, but he had enough for one more strike when he was alive, then ended up fading away, but not after telling Kirito not to heal him. It was a mess, but I really felt something, like all the emotions that Kirito and Yu-Gi-Oh were feeling. And how do I view the show? I could talk about why this scene is so great, or I could talk about why this scene is so bad, and I'd be telling the truth either way. So that's why my thoughts on SAO are so complicated. I like it, but I don't like it at the same time. So viewed as a whole, that's why I consider it's pretty much an average show, though there's so much to it. I also want to talk about some of the themes brought up in the final battle, and that's where SAO seems to have the most that makes it stand out. There's a lot brought up about love versus control, plus the whole idea of the administrator rebelling against the gods. Plus you have Kirito, from the world of the gods, coming to this world and fighting to save them. I don't know if it was intentional or not, but there's definitely some parallels to Jesus, which I find interesting. So that was a nice plus. But overall, was this season good? Well, it had a lot I liked. It had a lot I did not like. So yeah, I will give SAO season 3 a score of a 6 out of 10, making it the best SAO season yet, though that doesn't say all that much. And now that I think about it, I don't think I'm doing scores for reviews anymore, but I feel it's a good way to summarize my thoughts on the show, so I'm doing it here. Anyway, thanks for watching me rant about SAO for 20 minutes, and I hope you'll join me next time for me to rant about a different show.